Welcome back. We're glad you're watching the business show that airs weekdays here on Urban TV. Yes, at 10 p.m. it is. Now, let's talk you then through how to make money for this week. Now, how many times do you have trash and all you're thinking about is how to dump it? And how many times do the KCCA guys have to come to your place and how much do you actually pay for this trash? Now, there is a team that is turning trash into treasure. I am talking about Asante Waste Management that is reaping cash from trash. This week, on how to make money, the team did visit the Asante Waste Management team down in Luzira, where they operate from. And we did speak to Deogracius Emojo, who is the spokesperson of the company, who tells us how they are currently making some good money. And of course, after about 10 years, they are trying to beat the challenges. Of course, there are those that still exist, like power that is unstable, which somehow then affects how they produce or the cost, the capacity of their production as a company. But in this conversation, we'll be telling you as well how you could work with them and make some money, plus how innovations could change that trash to treasure. This is how to make money.
My name is Emojo Deogracius. I'm the customer service officer and also the PRO of Asante Waste Management. Asante Waste Management is a company under the Asante Group, which has got several other companies, for example, Asante Energy, Ram Industries, Asante Agro. Yeah, thank you.
Good stuff. Thank you so much for speaking to the business show. Maybe let's start with how you, maybe for starters, what exactly do you deal in?
Yeah. Asante Waste Management, we are a comprehensive waste management company that handles both hazardous and non-hazardous waste. Hazardous in the hazardous meaning, for example, waste from industries, waste from medical facilities, and then non-hazardous being the domestics, the usual waste that comes from homes, commercial buildings like hotels, restaurants, and all that. Yeah. We go collect, sort the waste, and then those that cannot be recycled are taken to the landfill. For example, in Chitezi and Katikolo in Mukono, yeah.
So when maybe just run us through there. So when you go out, select them, what happens after that?
Yeah, well, our emphasis as a company has been always to close the loop. What I mean by closing the loop is, previously we used to operate a CD model, collect and dump, or linear model in that case, whereby we go to our clients, pick their waste, and we take them to the landfill. But now we thought of innovations that what may necessarily be waste to you may not be waste to someone else. Mm. So what we usually do, we established a facility that we call the MRF. MRF in full being the material recovery facility, where after collecting our waste from our different clients, we take it to the MRF. And in the MRF, we have got a team of ladies and other workers who do the sorting and color coding of the various waste. For example, you know, in the waste category, we have the plastics, we have the bottles, we have the paper, we have the inorganics or biodegradables. So all that are coded. Those that we do not handle, for example, the biodegradables, are the ones that are taken to the landfill. But now the recyclables, for example, the bottles, like mineral water bottles, those ones are called PET. These disposable cups, they are called PP, polypropylene. Then we have cardboard, the boxes. We coat them and bale them. So each of them has got a value additional chain that we do to make sure that we add value to them. Yeah.
All right. So I know for a fact that waste management is one of the conversations that forever, you know, everyone talks about. Mm. Let me just run us through the, I would want to ask, the choice of why you ventured in this particular thing, in this particular, you know, business, and how has it been over the years that you've been in existence?
Yeah, well, first of all, that takes us back into the inspiration why you got into the business. Mm. You all know our managing director, Mr. Rodney Mokula. I think it was during his times of studying in the UK, the University of Kent, where he was staying with some of his friends, black friends. I know our mindset as the black people towards West is a little different from the white people. So their waste that they were generating from their hostel or their rooms was being rejected by their service provider. And the reason was because they're not doing waste segregation. And in fact, it reached a point where they were about to be fined for not segregating waste. So he carried that, if I may call it mentality, and brought it here. And he started a company, Asante Waste Management, I think 10 years ago, because this year we're celebrating 10 years. And what inspired us into that direction? Furthermore, truth be told, waste is like a gold mine. But that is something that people do not know. Because you see, even when you go to our clients to pick, they say, kasasiro. You get the point? Mm. That is the mindset people have. But really, the truth of the matter is, what may be waste to you may not be waste to someone else. For example, your old t-shirt. There's someone else outside there who can use it.
Yeah.
And these opportunities, as people, we have not explored. Now, that's how we started our journey as a company. Yeah.
Well, so let's talk about the strategies and how you handle the recycling and then, you know, composing and waste to energy solutions. How is all this done?
Yeah, currently now, remember we said closing the loop and we began with recyclables.
Yes.
Recyclables in this case being bottles, those are plastic bottles, being cardboard and paper, being wine glasses. But of course, you also have the other element of the biodegradables, which I will not talk about now, but I will give you a hint of what you're trying to do to close the loop. So when you pick the plastic bottles, they are brought into our material recovery facility, that's the MRF. From there, they are shredded. First of all, they are color-coded. If you remember the Pepsi and Crest bottles, previous ones, they used to be green. Mm. I think Coca-Cola has rebranded. They no longer have the green. Eh? But previously, when you used to have them, would color-code them. For example, the white or the transparent, the green ones, the paper, cardboard, there's the hard cardboard, then there's this office paper. So we code them or we classify them into those different categories. Now, talking about plastic bottles, we get them, we shred them. Shred means being cut into small pieces. After we have shredded them, we run them through our washing line. Our washing line, we have a washing line that we made locally, but also have a semi-automated washing line. So after they have been washed, they are blown and dried. After they have been blown and dried, they pass through a machine called the agglometer. Now the agglometer is the one that converts the shredded plastic bottles into something closer to powder, but they are still coarse and rough. Then from there, we feed it into a recycler, which further makes plastic granules. Now, plastic granules are the ones that are used by these plastic making companies to make different plastic products. For example, you know, these plastic chairs, plastic, it can be buckets, mention it.
Jerrycans.
They are put into a molding machine and blown. Mm-hmm. So instead of all this ending up in the landfill as waste, at least we give it a second, third, and fourth life through recycling. Then when it comes to bottles, we have an industry called RAM Industries. It's a subsidiary of Asante Group, because we do not want to deviate from our major role as Asante Waste Management, which is providing waste management services. Because you see, if you say you're providing waste management services and then here you're going into further recycling, it's a good thing, but you'll be stretched out. That's why we established another sister company to now, after Asante has brought the, for example, the raw material, it picks up from there to continue with the value chain. Mm. For the drinking glasses or the bottles, wine bottles, we pick them from our clients, like several bars around. We classify them still, and then we cut drinking cups, we cut flower vessels, we cut egg trays, we cut wind chains, and many other products. Actually, what runs that industry is innovation. We actually do not tell our people that work there that we want you to make this or that. Unless maybe when a client comes with a specific order. But they go there and use their innovation to come up with different amazing amazing pieces. Yeah.
There's a lot of other stakeholders involved in this whole, you know, chain of the business you know, yes. Find yourselves in. And also I've seen young guys move around with Bovera's picking bottles and stuff. Is there an arrangement where you have everyone, or how do you engage the entire community into this business?
Yeah, first of all, I'm going to talk away from two perspectives. The first one, waste being a global challenge, being a community challenge.
Yeah.
And as a company, we acknowledge that we cannot solve it alone. So one, we always do community outreaches and sensitization, teaching them majorly waste segregation, but also educating them that if they get to learn some of the practices when it comes to good practices when it comes to waste management, they will actually be reducing their carbon footprint and also reducing their waste, which at the end of the day will not be a big burden to them. So reach out to the community and teach them some of these things. And the other aspect that I can talk about is stakeholders like regulators.
Yes.
I'll talk about NEMA. NEMA is our premium regulator, but we also have KCCA and all local governments in all areas that we operate in. They come in terms of licensing, in terms of making sure that you are adhering to, okay, I will call it compliance. Mm. They are very key in that. Because for you to deal with waste, especially the hazardous, you really need to be compliant in order not to harm the environment and even harm the community. So we partner with them, and they have been very key in our operations. Mm. Yeah, that's what I can say.
Well, I can imagine this is like a huge kind of investment to make something like this happen. And could there be some of the problems that or challenges that you face as a company?
Yeah, definitely. First of all, as the business, it's a highly capital intensive business. Mm. But I appreciate how we have grown organically. We have grown organically by relying on, first of all, our cash flows, but also soft loans from our banks. And that's how we've been able to grow. However, now challenges, number one, we have the aspect of, you know, we're in the city. So we get some of those products from our clients, but as we are getting them, we are offering them service. So there is a challenge of traffic jam. So when there's a lot of traffic jam, sometimes we do not reach our various clients in time, or we do not service them as scheduled. So that at the end of the time, at the end of the day becomes a very big challenge. The other one is, as you know, 80% of operations is logistics. So we have truck breakdowns as a major challenge, because when you have truck breakdowns, I can bear you witness, it's one of the worst scenarios in our sector. Because remember, clients have generated a lot of waste, but at the end of the day, you're not in position to reach out to them in time because maybe the trucks that you had allocated on that route have broken down. So that's a very big major setback. Then another challenge that I would also talk about is, like I said, it's a highly capital intensive business. So some clients who work on them and at the end of the day they don't pay. Or many people have a mindset of paying for their waste management as the last priority.
Yeah.
Yet in actual sense, it's a service, an absolute service. It's an absolute service. I wish people could have a mindset of the way they pay for their yaka, the way they pay for their airtime, the way they pay for their DSTV, television, and all that, is the same way they do the same for waste management. Because at the end of the day, if we don't do our work, it will be a mess. The whole place will be a mess.
Okay. Yeah. So I know you probably operate in a place where you feel the government will say there's enough electricity, but the guys running industries and so on will tell you we need more power. Or if not, there must be a, you know, subsidized kind of like rate of the fee. Is it something that is affecting you guys?
Yeah, sure, it is. I'll talk about our machines. Sometimes we have shortages in power, uncommunicated, or maybe communicated, but maybe you have not been informed. Mm. And that really breaks us down as a company, especially our recycling arm. So when there are those shortages of power, it retards our production. And you know, as an industry, production must be consistent for you to break even. So if it doesn't happen, it breaks us down, yeah.
So let's see, it's very obvious now for you, yeah, that you can make money. You look at those bottles and the designs, and you probably have several of them in your house and you're wondering what to use them for. I tell you what, there are people who are turning almost everything that you have in your space to money. So you might want to reach to us and we tell you how you can link up with these guys and see how you can dump all those bottles at them and see if they can pay you, yeah? Of course. There's a whole challenge that Deo talks about of traffic jam that also hampers the movement of garbage to the plant where the operations or productions actually happen. We can only hope that these all addressed. We've seen, of course, KCC and the other partners really trying so hard to change things around the city. We hope this can take a shorter time than anticipated and guys get back to enjoying what they supposedly pay taxes for, yeah? Let's talk you then through personal finance tips for this week. And we are finally running the last episode with the CEO of Med Business Consult. And the whole conversation has been on understanding your business model. Before you embark on any business, do you understand your business model? And in our final episode this time, we are talking how you determine the cost of the business model before you embark on it. So you have to do things like creating streams through which the company will generate revenue, plus also ensuring that your business can offer unique products. This is Personal Finance, and the last episode I should be saying, please enjoy.
Good evening, viewers. Welcome to yet another edition of our business show. My name is Enoth Mbeine, your business coach. Last week, we were able to cover the various building blocks that we can apply for our business, and especially using the example of the food restaurant. We were able to cover the key resources as a key building block, customer relationships, and the delivery channels as important blocks to be able to understand our business and make better informed decisions. This week, I want us to cover the other three and last important building blocks for our business. The first one that we need to cover this week is the cost structure. The cost structure, in essence, looks at the costs that you incur when you're delivering your product or service. For example, if we're using the food restaurant, we shall look at the costs. For example, if you're renting, how much do you pay? If you are producing, we are cooking food, what are the costs of the inputs, the food that we are buying? That's also a cost that we need to look at. Our workers, our employees, need to be paid, so they need a salary. So that's also a cost to your business. The equipment that we are using, the utilities, for example, water and electricity, these are usual recurring costs that we need to compute at the end of the day. We need also to pay our taxes as a business to be able to conform to the regulatory system of the government or the local government. For example, paying the business license for the business. So how much are you paying? All these costs need to be imputed to be able to understand exactly what it takes for us to run our business. And these usually are direct costs and indirect costs that you need to calculate for your business. So now that we have understood the cost structure, let's look at the revenue streams. Revenue streams, like a river that is streaming, is the various channels or streams of how you can make money. Using again our example of the food restaurant, what are the various streams that can generate income for the food restaurant business? The major one, of course, is the selling of the food, selling of the of what we are cooking. So those are the food sales. But also we can involve, we can do other activities within our business as a food restaurant. For example, we can offer outdoor catering services. That will be another revenue stream. We can also venture into decorations of events. For example, if they have called us for a wedding or a baptism, and we do the decorations, and we do the whole event planning, that could be another avenue that can generate income for our business. The importance of analyzing a revenue stream is for you to be able to maximize the resources that are available in your business so that you're able to create an income for the business. Lastly, and very, very importantly, is our value proposition for the business. This is the core of the business model canvas. What is it that you're offering that is different from other businesses? Why should the business come and access or use your service instead of using the service for another business? What is it? What benefit are you offering your customers? How are you wowing your customers? This is the value proposition. If we again use the example of the food restaurant, we can say accessibility. If your location is very good, it's near a lot of business people around, and people can easily access it, that's a value proposition. If you're offering excellent customer care, the attendants are working very well, there's a good customer experience when people are in your restaurant, that is a value proposition that you can offer for the market. Another issue is you could probably be offering online deliveries. That's another value proposition. Somebody just orders food on an app or online and you're able to deliver. So that's what we call accessibility. Affordability. If your prices are good, that's also another value proposition in terms of affordability of your product to be able to attract more customers. Another way you can create a value proposition is, for example, to emphasize the importance of health eating. For example, or if you're cooking meals that are healthy, that's another value proposition. So, ladies and gentlemen, value proposition is one of the key essential blocks that helps you separate your business from the others. And it's extremely important for you to really understand what the value proposition of your business is. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to end here, but importantly, take very keen interest of these 9 key blocks of the business so that you're able to understand your business much better at the end of the day to make more profits and you grow. I thank you and good night.
So if you're looking to improve your business and not buy there, I have his contact. You can reach out to us and we can help you link up with him. He's equally a business coach, so he has a lot more lined up for you that would want to know how you can handle your finances. But also, if you have struggles with your business, are there things you think you want to ask but you're not very sure? We can have that conversation and, you know, help you link up with him. I keep saying that's why the business show exists. We're here to try help you understand some of the things that you can do implementing your business to help you change your operations, but also score some more money in your returns after your operational costs are put on the side. Let's talk you then through Forex and money market report. The shilling has been relatively stable for the whole part of the week. This is now the comprehensive report of the Forex and money markets. Thank you. So regardless now, or needless to say, that fuel prices seem to be a constant now, and after the start, I did see members of parliament complain. Looks like they finally settled in and realized that after all, they can afford the fuel anyway. Yeah, it's the business community that needs to struggle more to foot the bills to pay for the fuel that keeps going up all the time. The president did launch a new factory in Karamoja that will be producing cement. Good stuff. I did say at the start of the show that there was a whole Islamic banking operation that is starting in Uganda. Good stuff. And of course, there is also a report from IRA Insurance for the second quarter. Good stuff, and you know, as well. And finally, for you that is looking out to grow your business, or also expose or show off what you are making or you want to learn, we are countdowning now, or we are on the countdown, I should be saying, to the UMA Expo. The 29th edition will be happening. Vision Group, of course, is the key sponsors. So make your plans stable and see what you're going to do come the 3rd of October, which is about 2 weeks away now, and see how you can position your business to make that money. Talking money, I need to go out of this set and make more money. I'll see you soon. From me and the team, you take care of yourselves. Keep making the money as well.